This is Thriller Forever, a video series chronicling every detail in the construction, release, and lasting impact of Michael Jackson's musical juggernaut. While recording Billie Jean, Michael Jackson and his producer, Quincy Jones, constantly fought over the track. Some reports stating that Jones felt it was too weak to be included on the album, nor did he care for the bass line, wanting to cut its 29-second introduction. But Jackson insisted that it be kept, and asked Jones to give him co-producing credit for the track, as he felt that the finished product sounded very close to his demo. But Jones granted him neither, and the two fell out over it for several days. Despite the unmatched success of Billie Jean, Michael Jackson wasn't going to let his musical masterpiece have its moment before releasing his next smash from Thriller. Beat It was released on February 21, 1983, as the album's third single. From its opening electro chimes, this sounded unlike anything else you had heard from Jackson or any other black artist, in fact. After finishing the other tracks for the album, Quincy Jones still felt something was missing. Quincy saying that he felt the album needed, quote, a song like My Sharona, a black version of a strong rock and roll thing. With the ongoing backlash against disco making it necessary to make a stark switch from Off the Wall, Jones and Jackson were determined to make a rock song that would appeal to all tastes. Michael Jackson writing that, quote, I had been thinking I wanted to write the type of rock song that I would go out and buy, but also something totally different from the rock music I was hearing on Top 40 radio. The result was harder, grittier, rawer than anything Michael Jackson had embarked on before. Gone was the softness and sweetness that usually characterized his vocals, replaced by a more defiant and challenging delivery that is razor sharp. Jones saying, quote, we were very conscious of wanting a white rock and roll groove, and when Smelly wrote Beat It, we knew he'd come up with the nitroglycerin. Quincy spent weeks looking for a suitable guitarist for the song. Eventually, they found Steve Lukather of Toto to play the rhythm guitar parts. Lukather was working on the track when he heard that an Eddie Van Halen guitar solo was also going to feature. Quote, when they told me Eddie was playing on it, and they were trying to do a crossover record, I whipped out the Marshalls and did a wall of sound, he said. Quincy sent that back and said, quote, the guitars are too heavy. They'll never play this on R&B radio.
He goes, I love it, except the guitars are too heavy. I got to get this on R&B radio, pop radio, and rock radio. They wanted me to do this part, and they're standing there, and I did it a couple times. And Quincy's like, it's not really in the pocket, you know, lay in the pocket a little bit more. And Michael's gave me a couple little bit of directions and stuff. I got to try it again. And I started doing it. Michael started dancing around a little bit. I knew I was, and Quincy's like, that's great. Let's double that part, and blah, blah, blah. And that's the record.
Unfamiliar producing rock artists, when Van Halen came in to record his solo, Jones told him, quote, I'm not going to sit here and try to tell you what to play. The reason you're here is because of what you do play. Of course, Eddie Van Halen nailed it in three or four takes. Engineer Swedeen remembering, quote, that guitar solo is incredible. But I went in there when he was tuning and warming and I left immediately. It was so loud, I would never subject my hearing to that kind of volume level. Eddie Van Halen reminiscing that he did the solo for free as a favor, even though he technically didn't have permission. Quote, the band's policy was we don't do things outside of the band, and everybody was out of town, so I had no one to ask. I swear to God, I figured who's gonna know if I play on this black kid's record. Myth and rumor surrounded Eddie Van Halen's contribution, one being that a mystery blaze broke out in the control room as he played. Quote, Eddie was playing, and the monitor speakers literally caught on fire, recalled songwriter Rob Temperton. The speaker caught fire, and we were all thinking, like, this must be really good, this solo. Also, on the final version right before Van Halen's guitar solo begins, a noise is heard that sounds like somebody knocking at a door. It was reported that the knock was a person walking into Van Halen's recording studio. Another story claimed that the sound was simply the musician knocking on his own guitar. However, Jackson performed the knocking sounds himself by striking a drum case. He is even credited on the album as Drum Case Beater. Packed with killer hooks and a strong musical sensibility, Beat It pulls Michael Jackson into an urban world and relays the pressure of a young man needing to prove himself in a tough street environment. Michael takes total command with an impassioned vocal begging young men everywhere to stop the macho craziness inherent in gang life. motivated by memories of rumbles between rival gangs from the front window of his childhood home in Gary, Indiana. Even after being lifted out of poverty, arriving in Hollywood to become a star at an early age, Jackson continued to grow up in an environment poisoned by toxic masculinity, the same poisonous substance that infects boys who join gangs. His ex-boxer, steelworker father terrorized and whipped him and his brothers regularly. The palpable sense of urgency in Michael's voice as he sings, quote, "Don't want to see no blood, don't be a macho man," can easily be identified as a plea to temper emotions before it goes too far. As though coming from someone who firsthand experienced the trauma of machismo gone wild. However, music critics interpreted Michael's depiction of gang violence as being more rooted in Hollywood spectacle, rather than his experience on mean streets of Gary. Songfacts asserting, quote, "His interpretation of two gangs coming together to rumble was based on the celluloid interpretations that he'd seen, specifically West Side Story, which used gangs as musical art." Unsurprisingly, the 1961 musical adaptation was a huge inspiration for Jackson when composing Beat It. Its title lifted from the movie's opening line.
Beat it.
Its references become even more evident in the track's accompanying music video. News of a fight circulates a diner and pool hall where gang members arrive and the song begins to play. The camera cuts to Jackson lying on his bed as he contemplates the senseless violence. Jackson then dances his way towards the fight through the same diner and pool hall seen earlier. A knife battle takes place between the two gang leaders in a warehouse until Jackson arrives. He breaks up the fight and launches into a dance routine. Donning a zippered red leather jacket, black pants, white socks, and black loafers, the video ends with Jackson at the center of mass choreography with several synchronized dancers, introducing elements that would soon become his visual trademarks. The second video released for the Thriller album was originally going to be directed by Billie Jean director Steve Barron. But Barron's idea was for Beat It to take place on a ship full of white slaves, with Michael Jackson as the slave master. But even in the early MTV days, that just wasn't going to fly. So the video was written and directed by Bob Giraldi. Jackson asked Giraldi, at the time already an established commercial director, but who had never directed a music video, to come up with a concept for Beat It, because he really liked a commercial Giraldi previously directed. It was about a blind elderly couple who, instead of running from a rundown neighborhood all the other white people had fled from, chose to stay and throw a block party for all the young children in the area. Contrary to popular belief, the concept of the video was not based on the Broadway musical West Side Story, Giraldi instead drawing inspiration from growing up in Paterson, New Jersey. Quote, "I listened to the song over and over and realized it was about all the Italian hoodlums I grew up with. Everybody trying to be tougher than they are, but really we're all cowards at heart." The video, which cost Jackson $150,000 to produce after CBS refused to finance it, was filmed on Los Angeles's Skid Row in March 1983. The short film was Jackson's first treatment depicting black youth and the streets, so to add authenticity to the production, Jackson cast members of rival Los Angeles street gangs Crips and Bloods as extras. Giraldi adding that while shooting, things got a little tense, so he had them shoot all scenes with the gang members on the first day.
"Let me just throw the music on. Let me try and see if I can just diffuse the situation, and then we'll go home and I won't call the Crips and Bloods back tomorrow. I have enough footage of them anyway." Michael Jackson comes down the boxes and they start dancing. And then all of a sudden, the other dancers start flailing their arms and start dancing. And I'm watching the Crips and the Bloods. They're just lined up, supposedly watching this thing going on. But the looks on their faces are so fascinating. Watching young African-American, probably gay men. They were watching the beautiful grace and symmetry of the dance and the choreography that they knew, tough as they were, they could never do that.
In addition to around 80 genuine gang members, the video also featured 18 professional dancers and 4 breakdancers. The video's world premiere took place on MTV on March 31st, 1983, just when Billie Jean was building momentum. an idea of Frank DeLeo, the vice president of Epic Records, who convinced Jackson to release Billie Jean and Beat It in quick succession. With both videos going into hot rotation for much of the summer of 1983, DeLeo correctly predicted that both singles would reach the top 10 at the same time, Billie Jean making it to number 1, before being toppled by Come On Eileen, which stayed at number 1 for a single week, before Jackson reclaimed the top position with Beat It the following week. Billie Jean and Beat It therefore occupied the top 5 at the same time, a feat matched by very few artists.
I had played on Beat It, on Michael Jackson's record, and his album went to number 1, and our album was number 2. Our single was number 1, his single was number 2. Then he did that Pepsi commercial, he burned his hair, and he stayed at number 1.
Selfish, man.
To this day, you know, the guys in the band still blame me for that album not going to number 1.
The single remained at the top of the Hot 100 for a total of 3 weeks. With sales of over 10 million worldwide, Beat It is one of the best-selling songs of all time and received the 1984 Grammy Award for Record of the Year and Best Male Rock Vocal Performance, as well as 2 American Music Awards. However, Beat It's impact extended far beyond just sales figures, as it decimated segregated radio formats and reshaped the future of pop music. Island Def Jam chairman L.A. Reid remembers being blown away. Quote, "Today we do things called mashups," he said. "Take Linkin Park and Jay-Z and put it together, and it's certainly unique, but it's not unusual." But at that time, Eddie Van Halen was at the top of his game and fit right in with Beat It. It didn't feel like a guitar solo over some R&B track. It was very organic. The idea of it was really unusual, but the results weren't strained at all.